Hi, y'all. Meteorologist Andy Hill here at the Weather Forecasting Desk this fine Saturday, April 22nd. If you've been missing spring, and it stayed far too cold and rainy along the West Coast for your liking, don't fret. I've got some great news for you. Things are changing as we head into the end of the month of April. From SoCal all the way up north into Vancouver, it may be time to dig out the sunscreen pretty soon here. This is because we have a huge ridge building into the West Coast, a ridge meaning an area of high pressure and fair conditions. Along with this expected temperature boost, it also seems like there's going to be a few days of sunny weather, especially into next weekend, and that's going to be much needed after such a long stretch of mild and rainy conditions, especially for our friends in the Pacific Northwest. That's a few days in the 70s degrees Fahrenheit with plenty of sun for Seattle and Portland, 80s degrees Fahrenheit for NorCal, and even 20 degrees Celsius for Vancouver for a few days here. Look at these temperatures popping up nicely here. All you have to do is make it through a few more days of rainy mild weather this week. Picnic time is just around the corner next weekend, and it's gonna last a few days. Now, if you're in the central part of the country, especially north of Oklahoma, a lot of us are going to be seeing late season freezes, especially into Sunday morning, April 23rd. All of these areas in dark purple are freeze warnings that do extend also with freeze watches into Sunday morning. Temperatures definitely expected to dip below freezing, which could damage a bunch of crops in this area. There are also several frost advisories issued as far east into Kentucky and southern Illinois and southern Indiana as well for the same time period. At the same time, a surface high pressure here in the orange and yellows should give a lot of us a few sunny days in the central U.S. here before some unsettled weather moves through from west to east at the start of the week, particularly for the southern plains. Right now, that's not expected to be anything too severe. All of these are the next week's outlooks from the Storm Prediction Center, and there aren't any areas of severe weather highlighted for now through the next week. That can always change as we get closer to these days, but right now the signal is dampened. We'll talk about why later on in this video. However, if you're in the eastern states today, the weather is active right now. Looking at temperatures again, over here in the eastern U.S., you're going to get another brief warm-up today as the heat gets blown up your way before being plunged back into chilly weather once this cold front passes through from west to east. So all this warm weather today on Saturday is for Ottawa, Montreal, and almost all of the East Coast folks here. Once that chilly weather makes its way through, your daytime high should drop, you know, about 10 to 20 degrees Fahrenheit, except for Florida, of course. Y'all stay warm for a while. It's hard to get the large-scale weather patterns to really scour out that heat down there. Now, on Sunday, April 23rd, we might be set for a moderate to major aurora viewing event here, and this is as we head into Sunday night time zones. We have a G3 strong geomagnetic storm predicted by the Space Weather Prediction Center as a part of NOAA. Forecasting space weather is a lot more chaotic and unpredictable in some ways than forecasting thunderstorms, but I definitely want to include it today in this video because exactly a month ago on March 23rd this year, there was a G4 solar storm, or the second highest level, that led to an incredible aurora display seen as far south as Oklahoma and even Northern California. It was my first aurora that I saw in person, and it was visible to the naked eye, which is pretty rare. When I saw it with my eyes, it was mostly grayish with some muted greens, but there were ribbons of color showing up right overhead though, and even some storming or pulsing effects, which is super rare. So here's a forecast for where the aurora could be seen overhead on Sunday night in the US time zones. This is for April 23rd. When the forecast looks like this, everybody a couple states down from this green line actually might be able to see the aurora on the horizon, as this forecast is for when it's directly overhead. The potential for all that I saw last month is actually similar tomorrow, but it may end up on the moderate side, we're not sure yet. If it is on the moderate side, it'll mostly only be visible in the upper Midwest, the Great Lakes region, northern New England, and perhaps parts of Washington state. Regardless, aurora fans are gearing up worldwide. If it starts up earlier, Nordic states and Iceland and Scotland could definitely get in on the action on Sunday. And if this energy from the sun hits the earth at just the right orientation, social media is going to be flooded with aurora pictures from everybody, for us all to gawk at. So at any rate, now I'm going to take a look at the lower end severe weather risks in place over the next week, starting today, Saturday. So our focus today involves this pretty large slight risk, or 2 out of 5 from the Storm Prediction Center over the East Coast here, parts of the Mid-Atlantic states. This does include Charleston, North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, Wilmington, North Carolina, parts of Eastern Virginia, and into the Delmarva area. This risk risk as well as the risk in Texas are both going to be primarily for damaging wind and also hail for these regions, though there will be a marginal threat for those pesky brief spin-up tornadoes. So a few tornado warnings might be seen here in the evening hours on the East Coast in this area highlighted in yellow. That's happening as our large-scale low-pressure system is moving off to the north and east into Canada, and its attendant cold front is sweeping east and off into the Atlantic Ocean. You can see from the HRRR model here our accumulated precipitation as we go through the day today into tomorrow. It seems like morning storms are currently dropping half an inch or so for Myrtle Beach and through the Piedmont as I'm recording this video. This morning convection is robust on its own, as there were plenty of small hail reports north of Charlotte, as well as a preventative tornado warning issued north of Charlotte as well for Mooresville. And it was preventative because this area is far away from any radar sites, so we can't really tell what's happening at the surface. Then, the main line attached to the cold front swings through later in the afternoon into the evening from west to east in the slight risk area here. It'll continue into Saturday night, right about now, through Sunday evening into New England, dropping plenty of widespread totals of an inch or more in rainfall. But up here, it'll lose all of its severe risks. There's no instability in place. So all you're going to see up here is some occasional lightning with any stronger cells dropping a bunch of rain. Some of the Catskills, Adirondacks, and even Green Mountains here are going to see isolated amounts of over 2, maybe even 3 inches of rainfall. Here's a look at those storms developing. This is an infrared satellite radar loop, and it really shows you those storms developing in North Carolina, eastern North Carolina through the evening hours. This really shows you how there's multiple rounds of storms expected today with this cold front passing through eventually, and the weather clearing out back behind the strongest storms popping up here around 5 to 6 p.m. through the eastern half of the state here toward the coast. There's another weather phenomenon going on simultaneously. These rapidly developing brief snow showers in the Great Lakes region are falling around the center of the low pressure system here with time. Wherever these impact regions briefly for a few minutes, there may be some reduced visibility as we go through the weekend here, especially for Chicago, parts of Minnesota and Wisconsin, and western Michigan. Now on Sunday, not too much is going on in Texas for any remnant severe weather risks we have, but this cold front is extending all the way back here into South Texas, and out ahead of it, we will have some potential supercells with wind and hail through the day on Sunday for our friends in Corpus Christi and Brownsville areas. Now, a few days ago, we did have an extended area highlighted for a severe weather risk next Tuesday in parts of Central Texas from the Storm Prediction Center. That risk has since vanished, so we're going to take a look a few miles above the surface to discover why that threat may have been muted, why the Storm Prediction Center is like, maybe this isn't going to be too much of an issue. So here we are, midday on Tuesday. And this is our little troublemaker here, this little low pressure system, or a shortwave trough, here over the Rockies. You can see it slide down from the Pacific Northwest over the previous 2 days and get into position on Tuesday. Now, normally, out ahead of this thing, this would translate into warm, moist air being pulled into the southern states from the Gulf of Mexico as a counterclockwise response to this low pressure spinning up here. However, at the same time, you can see the rest of this map here is just blue. That previous trough that's sweeping through and giving us storms today sticks around for a few more days, and it's really preventing this smaller system up here from dragging this moist air very far inland. So what that means is that a lot of the south and the southeastern states are going to have another period of unsettled, rainy weather through the start and middle of the weeks for these areas respectively. And we'll have to watch if severe weather risks organize in these areas in this rainy period through the end of the week. Right now, it's a little far out to tell at this small of a scale. We're going to really have to focus on those mesoscale, the smaller scale influences, to see if something does organize on those days. So this will very much be a, oh hey, we need a forecast video update if something does look to be pretty gnarly. So to close out this forecast, let me explain one thing to you that you might have heard over and over again, but you're like, I don't really know what the heck that is. What the heck is a trough? Troughs and ridges are simply shapes of the data that we're looking at in whatever weather map that we're showing. That could be temperature, moisture, instability, or even nadir juice. But most often, and what you're looking at right now, we're talking about a map of atmospheric pressure. The atmospheric pressure on your head is simply the weight of all of the air directly above your head. We can extend that definition to look at any specific point in the atmosphere. So when we identify a trough, we're usually looking at about 4 miles above the surface. Here at 4 miles above the surface, the waviness of the atmosphere makes itself very clear, and we can see fundamentally what weather patterns are evolving as a result of this layer. This would be in terms of troughs, or low pressure, generally meaning unsettled weather, and high pressure, or ridges, which give way to fair weather, like we're going to see next weekend here in Pacific Northwest, giving us those warm temperatures and sunny skies for quite a few days. So that's a very basic look at troughs and ridges, literally what we're looking at, what we're looking for when we talk about those features, or blue blobs, to put in the way that Ryan says. So I hope that begins to help some. There will always be more to learn, though. This field of science is incredibly deep, and even I'm learning new things every day. So make sure you sub to the channel and watch some of my live streams back if you want to absorb as much as possible. I've got that all public for you on this channel. Thanks for watching, and hopefully you can enjoy some of that beautiful weather I talked about coming up soon.